with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart?
Then shall I bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Until that day,
your kingdom come, deliver us from I was searching for a feeling hidden in my head on the ceiling for so long, so long. I was broken under my skin in the shadows. I was hiding so long.
Lord Jesus, we welcome you to this place. Holy Spirit, just have your way. As we draw closer to you, Lord God, we know that you are drawing closer to us, Lord Jesus. We lift up our hands and worship you, God. With all I am, we worship you, Lord Jesus.
This alabaster jar is all I have worth. Break it at your feet, Lord. It's less than you deserve. You're far more beautiful, more precious than the oil. The sum of my desires and the fullness of my joy. Like you spilled your blood, I spill my heart as an offering to my King. Here I am. Days are few. You gave your life for me, and I will give my life for you. You spilled your blood, I spilled my heart as an offering to my King. Here I am, take me as an
Take me.
as an offering. Here I am giving, and every heartbeat for your glory. Take me. Take me. Worship you, Jesus. Take me. And I love you. All of my hope is in you. Jesus Christ, take my life, take all of me. And I love you, all of my hope is in you. Jesus Christ, take my life, take all of me. Take all of me. You broke the night like the sun and healed my heart with your great love. And any trouble I couldn't bear lifted me upon your shoulder. Love that's stronger, love that covers sin and takes the weight of the world. And I love you, all of my hope is in you. And Jesus Christ, take my life, take all of me. I love you, and I love you. All of my hope is in you. Jesus Christ, take my life, take all of me. You stand on mountaintops with me, and with you I walk through the valleys. You gave your only son for me. Your grace is all I rely on. Love that's stronger, love that covers sin and takes the weight of the world. And I love you, and all of my hope is in you. Jesus Christ, take my life, take all of me. And I love you, and all of my hope is in you. Jesus Christ, take my life, take all. Thank you. soul, and I give of my heart to say I need to you so. You're my everything.
In your own words, just worship the Lord. Just tell him how much you love. Just close your eyes and engage in worship. Just worship the Lord. If you want to lift up your hands, just lift up your hands. Just tell him how much you love him. Just adore him. We adore you, Lord Jesus. We love you, Lord Jesus. Love you, Lord Jesus. You're my everything. You're my everything. You're my everything, Lord Jesus. And I love you so, and I give up my heart to say I need you so. You're my everything. I will live to love you. I will live to bring you praise. I will live a child in all.
Lift up our hands, come on.
I will live to love you, yes. I will live to bring you praise. I will live a child in awe of you. See you face to face, and grace amazing takes me home. I trust in you. Oh, and I will live
every hand's lifted up and sing.
And I will live to love you. I will live
to bring you praise.
I will live a child in awe of you. Sing, I will live. And I will live to love you. I will live to bring you praise. I will live a child in awe of you.
That you have displayed on the cross for me is unbelievable. And today we stand in awe of this love that you have for us. We think that we know what love is, but our love to anyone, our love even for you, can never compare to the love that you have for us. You have not held back anything for us. You never hold back when it's about us. That's how great your love is for us. Hey, listen up for a moment. This is a month of love. And we try to seek and we try to understand what is love. And we believe we found love in other people, in our work, in so many things in this world. But hey, you don't know what love is until the day that you stand in the presence of God, just embracing everything that He has for us. Hey, this is the place where we can experience real love in His presence. And you are here tonight on February 14th. And this is the place of love, because He is the source of love. He Himself is love. Nothing can compare to His love. And Father, we want to soak in this moment. We just want to soak in, because You're pouring out Your love for us day after day after day. Just when we wake up and we breathe in, this is Your love for us. We see the nature, we see the birds, we see the sun. This is Your love for us. Not just enough, more than enough is what You have for us. And so we just want to soak in this moment
and just stand in awe of you, because there's nothing we can do. There's nothing else we can do. We just want to stand in awe of you. And so tonight, this is about you and you alone. It's not about our own agenda. It's about you and you alone. Today we stand here as children in awe of our Father in heaven. Thank you, Father, for your love, your fatherly love that you're pouring over us. Hey, you want to know good news tonight? There is nothing that you can do that could ever separate you from His great love. Amen? Come on, can you worship Him one more time with your own words? Thank you. Thank you so much for everything that you've done. Thank you for what you've given to us. Thank you, Father, for not holding back. Thank you, Father, for second chances, for third chances, for so many chances that you've given us. And I just want to praise you. Just want to praise you tonight with everything that we have. We want to give you this night. We want to give you every day of our lives as a living sacrifice. Father, we love you. We love you. We love you. And what a blessing it is, Father, that nothing in this world, nothing we could say, nothing we could do, could ever separate us from your great love. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We lift up this evening. We lift up this evening, and we say it one more time. We love you. Come on, say that. We love you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen and amen. Come on, give it Him your best one more time. Yes. Hey, you can sit down for a moment, but I want to show you a quick video. It's only 60 seconds, but it's just amazing. This video was just released this week. It's 60 seconds, and it's something special about that video. Watch that out.
Don't ask me what you know is true. Don't have to tell you I love your precious heart. I was standing, you were there, two worlds colliding, and they could never tear us apart.
He gets us, all of us. Jesus didn't teach us hate. He washed feet. Hey, there's something else about this video. It shows the love of God for us. Jesus loves all of us. There is no exemption. But there's something else I want to tell you about this video. This was shown as an advertisement, a 60-second ad during last Sunday's Super Bowl. This group paid $100 million, dili peso, US dollars, for 60 seconds to spread the love of God to the world. And you know what was my first thought when I heard that? I said, that's crazy. $100 million? Of course, I work with the poor. I said, I could have done so much. You could have built so many churches around the world. But they used it for a 60-second video clip. And you know what God reminded me of? The alabaster jar. We just sang that song. Hey, it reminded me of so many stories in the Bible where people worship God with everything that they have, and then there are people standing there like, what is this person doing? And I had a real Judas moment when I thought about this $100 million clip for 60 seconds. But hey, they just wanted to spread the love of God. They responded with everything they have to worship God. And this is what counts for God. It doesn't matter how many million it cost. It doesn't matter how much it cost. The ointment that this woman broke for Jesus. But this is worship. Worship, we are so many times so technical about worship. But I was just amazed this week knowing about this advertisement. And we don't know how much this can go. Yes, it might be 60 seconds during the Super Bowl. But how many millions and hundreds of millions saw this clip? That Jesus is for all of us. Jesus gets all of us. Hey, and so this is just a reminder for me this week to say, hey, Manu, how much do you really worship God? Do you worship God with everything you have? Or did you find your default kind of worship that you do? And so tonight, young adults, there's a brown envelope that you sit on. This is one way of worshiping the God that didn't hold back for us. And it doesn't matter how much you put in there. If it's 100 peso, if it's 100 million peso, it doesn't matter as long as it's from your heart, because this is what counts for God. So Heavenly Father, as we come into your presence, we do not come empty-handed. We come to give you our offering, our worship tonight. And we don't want to be technical about it, because everything we have is a gift that comes out of your hand. So Father, tonight we worship you with our time, but even with our finances, we worship you and we don't want to hold back from you. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Hey, give cheerfully tonight. Amen.
Traffic was terrible, but we're glad you made it. And I hope.
Of Jared. Yo, there's Jared. No, that was the one doing the voiceover was Jared. Can you appreciate Jared in the house? There he is. Yo, man, I got you. Okay, we really appreciate the talent that is in the room and those that are, you know, pitching in to help what we're doing here. And I believe that God is using more and more people to just jump in on board. If you have skills, talents, you want to learn how to stream, use a camera, you want to sing and be a part of the band, you just approach any of your kuyas and ates. No, hindi na kuyas and ates. You're probably the same age. Approach any of the leaders in the house and just ask and inquire. We'll help direct you where you ought to go. All right? I think I'm coming in too loud. Sir, can you lower it a bit? They might think I'm angry and shouting. Stand to your feet. Let's just close in prayer. Let's pray. Open in prayer first. Valentine's. Well, shout out to my wife who has left for Manila. So I'm really hurting at this very moment. And what's worse is I got home and somebody gave my daughter flowers. I really didn't want to show up, you know, today. I'm really broken. So I'm not ready for that. I'll use it as a bonfire tonight. So it's going to be good. Father, we just bless you and we thank you that we can just laugh, have fun, but at the same time, come closer to your heart. You've been so good and so faithful. And Lord, I know those that have come here tonight, you've brought them here for a purpose in Jesus' name. Everyone said, amen. All right, you may be seated. I'll try to cover as much ground as I can in about 10 to 15 minutes. And then I'm going to call a wonderful couple to be here with us so that we can answer more questions about relationships, okay? We're going to do a question and answer. We're going to pass on papers later. I've been a pastor for quite a while, especially with the youth and young adults. I was still in Manila. And in every youth camp, I've seen a lot of breakups. I've seen a lot of restoration and makeups as well. But I think the biggest question that has been asked every single time is, who am I going to marry? If it's God's will or not, who is God's will? So I want to start off today with three questions and a few rules. I want to present to you three better questions to ask than asking the question, who am I going to marry or who is my God's will? And with these three questions, I want us to approach this subject of relationships differently, more mature. I might say some stuff that might be hurtful to some, but I'm not here to condemn people, honestly. We're not here. If you've been here long enough, you should know that we're not here to point the finger out to you, because everyone that stands here today, we're not perfect people. And I want to present to you what the Bible says. I've had my own set of mistakes. You know, I'd share my testimony here, my own mess ups in life. Only Pastor JP is the one that's really strong among us. He's different. And of course, Pastor Manu, all around, you know, loving, handsome, you know. Of all of the three, ako yung trapo, you know, that the Lord died for me. So I received the Lord more than they, because of all my sin. Okay, but seriously, here's the question that I think you should ask instead of saying, Lord, is he the one? Is she the one? Is he or she my God's will? Number one, it's this. What kind of marriage do I want to have? Because if you can answer that question, it'll be easier for you to determine the type of person you want to be and the type of person you want to look for. So think about this. What do I want my marriage to look like in 20 years? I think any person can answer that. You can easily say, hey, in 20 years, I want my spouse to be my best friend. That's a good picture. In 20 years, I want there to be a lot of joy and laughter in my household. In 20 years, I want to see a house where there's complete trust, there's honesty, there's no shadows, there's no skeletons in the closet. I want a marriage that I feel affirmed, understood, respected, loved. There's always peace. I want a marriage where we're always a team. And yeah, we argue, but you know, we always patch things up and we come back stronger. I want a marriage where I feel first and prioritized. You see, anybody can answer this question without even blinking. And with that first question, it already changes the atmosphere of your own life. Why? Because now, if you're in a relationship, you can look at the person. Don't look at them if they're beside you, okay? But you can look at and evaluate your relationship and say, can this person be my best friend 20 years in the marriage? Is it worth building a life with this person? Because if not, then it's not going to work. So the second would be this. Because we've answered the first, second would be this. What kind of person do I need to be to have this kind of marriage? That's an interesting question, right? So after you ask yourself, what do I want my marriage to look like in 20 years? Then the next question would be this. When I reach the day that I'm walking down the aisle, what type of person do I need to be walking down the aisle? And I love that question because before you point elsewhere, it's you first. Because you will discover in marriage, Pastor JB, Pastor Mano can tell you this, you can never change your partner. You can only change you. That's the truth. You can pray all you want. God can change your partner, but you cannot change your partner. You'll just get frustrated. And if they make promises to change for you, that's not going to last. Promise, babe, I won't smoke, I won't drink, I'll stop this, I'll stop that. If they make the promises to you because he's human or she's human and you're human too, it's going to fail. You see, the promises they need to make is between him, her, and God, period. Right? And from there, you pray that God changes the heart because outside of God's move, we can't change our partner's heart. And I'm sorry if you're here and you're married and you're trying to change them, it's not going to work. Why are you so quiet? Are you wishing now you want to be on a date? Why did I come here? But the third question would be this, just three questions. What kind of person do I need to look for to have this kind of marriage? So you can evaluate now. Instead of just saying, Lord, I really want him to be my God's will, her to be my God's will. Is it possible that it's she's the one or he's the one? It's saying, Lord, what kind of marriage do I want to have so that I can serve you in a way that's different in the next 20 years of my life? Because I can tell you, some marriages, you get into it and it's wrong. Man, how can you even serve the Lord if you're trying to put out fires in your own household? Just a reality check, okay? Are we good? Let's close in prayer. Lord, in Jesus' name. Now I'm just, okay, just those three questions for you to evaluate, but I want to give you direct to the point about three or four rules that I personally stand by, and I pray today that before we get into the question and answers, this will give you a framework and a reference about relationships. Number one, rule number one, some marriage lang ang forever. I'll tell you that. If you're stepping into marriage and you believe in divorce, you're already beginning your marriage journey divided. It's not going to work. Right? If you start out something and you're divided, it's going to mess up everything. Because divorce is like having a back door. Oh, some of you didn't know there was a door here. Huh? It's like having a back door that you know at any point when you reach your threshold, you can run. So to step into marriage and say, you know what? I do believe in divorce. I've read it somewhere in the Bible. So I'm going to use that back door and leave it open. Wrong notion. If not, you're going to walk down the aisle. You're already divided and you haven't even started. Are you following? So consider what you think about divorce. What's your views about divorce and being separated? Again, number two, rule number two, I'll move quickly. This is something that really hit me just recently again when I was reviewing my notes. It's purity before purpose. Yeah, as young adults, we're so crazy about, hey, what's your purpose? Find your purpose. But I'll tell you the truth. You cannot find your purpose if you're not walking in purity. Because when you walk in purity, you're walking in the will of God. Then you discover your purpose. So you can try to be the person that says, oh, Lord, I want your purpose for my life. I want everything. And God says, how will I give you my purpose for your life if you're not faithful in the little things? You can't walk in purity. You're never going to discover your purpose. Because the only place to discover your purpose really is in the will of God. So purity is the only pathway to purpose. You following me? Am I saying neglect purpose, only purity? No, of course not. Prioritize purity and then discover purpose. Because you want to be walking right when you hear God's voice. Amen. You still with me? Here, really quick, Romans 12. I've got proof for you. It's in the scripture. Listen to this. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that he will find acceptable. That's purity. This is truly the way to worship him. Verse 2, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. And then here goes. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. You see the order? It's when you walk and your life is a living sacrifice, then the Bible says, you'll be able to determine and see clearly what the will of God is. So it's always purity over purpose. You don't know your purpose yet? I guarantee you walk in purity, you'll discover it in the journey. Amen? Do you still wish you're on a date somewhere? All right. Another verse. Look at this. Real clear. 1 Thessalonians 4:1-8. I'll read the whole thing because I think it speaks for itself. Listen to what it says. Finally, dear brothers and sisters, we urge you in the name of the Lord Jesus to live in a way that pleases God. Purity. And as we have taught you, you live this way already, he says, and we encourage you to do so even more. For you remember what we taught you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. God's will is for you to be what? Holy. It says here, so stay away from all sexual sin. Then each of you will control his own body and live in holiness and honor. You know this number 4, it says each of you will control his own body. So that reasoning, which I used many times before, doesn't work. Lord, if it's not your will, stop me. Pull me back, Lord. Hey, you're naked na. Imagine, huh? You're already naked. Lord, if it's not your will, you know, let my clothes reappear in my body. It's not going to work. So Paul says, as you decide to live in purity, you learn to discipline and control your own body. And outside that discipline, it becomes worship unto the Lord. Amen? So don't feel bad if you feel like you've failed in certain areas. I think all of us here at different points in our life have had points of failure. But the point of a message like this is to encourage you to get back up and then start walking in purity. You don't have to wait till tomorrow to walk in purity. Start today. Start now. This very moment. And I'll read what it says here. Next, verse 5. I'll read verse 4 again. Then each of you will control his own body and live in holiness and honor, not in lustful passion like the pagans who do not know God and his ways. Never harm or cheat a fellow believer in this matter by violating his wife, for the Lord avenges all such sins as we have solemnly warned you before. God has called us to live holy, holy lives, not impure lives. Therefore, anyone who refuses to live by these rules is not disobeying human teaching, but is rejecting God who gives his Holy Spirit to you. Nice, no? All sexual sin. I love the word that they use because we have created many new sexual sins that did not exist probably in Bible times. But this text encapsulates every sexual sin, okay? So let's just, how many minutes do I have left? Just maybe 5 or a few? Okay, very strict on SM. So with regard to purity, I'll just put it out there. One of the rules I gave the young men before when I was a youth pastor, I said, hey guys, because they kept pushing me and they say, Brian, please tell us how far is far, until where can I go? It's those crazy questions. And I tell them, guys, the moment you ask the question, how far can you go, that tells me that you want to walk the edge, right? And because you know where the line is, you're going to walk that edge as far as you can. And right before you fall, up, you go back, okay, too much. Then you go onto the edge again and you're just going to run it. And we were talking about purity, not really being a line, but a direction. See, it's not really a line that you should cross until where, but it's a direction your heart is going. So instead of going nearer the edge and say, how far can I go? It's how far can I go toward God so that I can stay farther from the edge. Are you following me? So for men, I would tell the youth, okay, you really want a line? Okay, can you work hard just above the neck? Oh, this is complaining in the youth. Oh, you mean neck up lang? I can't go below? Yeah, you asked me for a line. I gave you a line. Now you're complaining. Get out of the youth. I'll tell them again. If you can't deal with it. He said, but what if we cross? And I said, you see, that's a different thing. If you know you cross and the fact that you're asking me a question, you know you don't feel right about it. Because otherwise, we won't be having this conversation, right? And some of you are looking at me and saying, why did we go here tonight? For women, it's really simple as well. It's, you know, a way of being pure is to walk in purity, is to dress modestly. And we've said this so many times, even in the waterfront, that if you dress sexy, you're going to attract people that want sex. If you dress in a way that's revealing, you're going to attract a certain crowd. But I'm not saying that every violation toward women is because of how they dress. That's also not true. There's also crazy perverts out there. But if you can control what you wear, then you should, right? Every single day, you don't have to dress like a person that's super conservative, that you'll be the laughing stock, but you dress up in such a way that you're conscious of what others might think and who you attract toward you. Are we okay with this? Yes, ladies? Because I've really seen, and in church, it's very distracting. You know those skirts that are so short, and the moment they see it, wala na, that's it, it's gone. All you see is skin. Men cannot worship that way in church. Someone sits like that, oh, that's it, it's gone. Yet, whether it's our fault or yours, you control what you can control. And if you can control the way you dress, it'll be a big help to everyone around you. Amen? And here's a tough one. Rule number three, and I'll end here. Christians marry Christians. This is a big debate all the time. This is a big debate. Now, houses have foundations, and a house is only as strong as its foundation. Marriages have foundations. And I'll tell you, if you read Psalm 127, it says, unless the Lord builds the house, its laborers labor in vain. The whole context of Psalm 127 is the family. The builder is the husband and wife. If your foundation is not centered in God, it's really not going to work. Again, we'll repeat this. If you start off your marriage with two different and opposing views, you start off divided already. And I think this is a bigger challenge for us, because really, we've said this as well many times in the past. If you love Jesus, why in the world would you marry someone who doesn't? Simply put, if you love Jesus at a level 8, don't marry someone who loves Jesus at a level 2. That's really hard, because you're going to try to pull them up to an 8. You're going to get frustrated, and your paths are different. An 8, that's kind of a big priority to you. So if that's a big priority to you, why will you settle for someone who loves him 3 or 2 or 1 or 0 or negative, right? And one of the hardest things to swallow is that there's so many people in relationships that are questionable. And that's what makes it hard. And to ask the big question, no? Is she a Christian? Is he a Christian? Oh, he's so good looking. You know, he loves to sing. He goes with me to church. But they can't answer the main thing and say, no, this person believes in Jesus, is a Christian, is mature, and can lead me and grow me, and we can actually grow together. Are you following me? You're also quiet today. Yeah, so general rule, I'm not going to quote verses, you know, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. There's so many verses that you can be careful who you get in bed with. Remember Jonah ran from God, got into a boat, the whole boat encountered a storm. They had to throw Jonah out, then everyone was saved. Be careful, the storms that come into your life might be a person, because you're in the wrong place with the wrong person, and a storm will come and you're blaming God. And the moment that person is out of your life, whew, peace. So be careful who you connect to, who you're in bed with, how you live your life, making those choices. Are you with me? So just three basic rules. Christians marry Christians. Rule number two, it's purity over purpose. And of course, number one is... Ma'am, paki-post na lang number one. I'll just walk out after this. Number one, can you post number one so they can see? Get 1, 2, 3. Rule number 1, 2, and 3. Do you have it like on a summary... No? Ah, that's right. It's your view about divorce. Are we okay with this? Yeah? This is just a quick framework. I'm going to call Pastor JP and his wonderful wife, Shello, to join me here on stage. I'm going to ask our ushers and all our SMs if they can help distribute pieces of paper. Now, you can ask any relationship question. Doesn't have to be related to this, but it can be. And it can be situational. It can be something that your friend is going through. Usually it's like that, no? I have a friend who is, but it's you. But it's fine. It's fine. That's fine. Okay, we'll walk with that. You don't have to put your name. We want to keep it anonymous. But hey, listen to this. The purpose of this is we want you to go home with a bigger piece of the wisdom of God. All right? How many of you know that it takes a lot of wisdom to walk in a relationship? Come on. Yeah. And how many of you want wisdom tonight? Yeah, so keep us in prayer. We prayed before we started. We want to make sure that we just don't give you cheesy answers. We want answers that can guide you and help you. Hey, don't be ashamed to pick a piece of paper. It doesn't mean if you get one, you have to write. But get one, because sometimes as we answer questions, a question might pop up in your head. Then just go ahead and write, okay? Can I just say a quick prayer before we jump into this? Yeah? Father, we want to enter this portion of the service. Really, yes, it's fun and we know it's real and raw. But mostly, Lord, we thank you that your Spirit is here. And we can walk out of this place with wisdom to make the right choices, to make changes if necessary, so that we build each other up. So, Lord, we acknowledge we can't do it on our own. We need each other. We need help. So we're opening ourselves to be vulnerable tonight to whatever you decide to do with us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, are you ready? Okay. Oh, you have your microphone. Okay, good. So, Tito JP and Tita Shello are actually the heads of the young couples ministry. And I want to introduce them as such because when you are on the road to getting married, the premarital counseling, we're going to see each other often, but ultimately you'll get plugged into the ministry that they handle to be around other couples. Amen? And you're going to be in safe hands with them. Amen? You might want to say a few things, sir and ma'am.
Well, you know, I really get conscious or like nervous when I speak alone, but when I'm with my wife, parang
that's it.
No, I'm so nice. Valentine's. What a wonderful time to spend Valentine's with my wife. In front, it's purposeful, you know. You. We're actually helping other couples. No, this is the fact that okay, we want you young professionals to get it right for the very first time. Correct. The reason why we're here is because we care about your future. We care about your marriages. In fact, we want to help you prepare rather than you come to us for repair. Yes. Get me? And that's why the Lord has been moving in our life and in the ministry. But I'm so glad that I'm with the best wife in the world. So
amen.
Here's my Valentine.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to commend all of you for being here tonight. Yes. Can you imagine? It's Feb 14. And we didn't expect that there's going to be a lot who will come tonight because maybe you have your own thing to do. But I'm so glad to see this group, and we're so happy to be here. We will try our best to answer the questions that you have. And please don't hesitate because the only reason why we're here is really by God's grace.
And you could have been on a date.
On how He has worked in our lives, in our relationship while we were dating, and of course now while we're married. That's why we are here, guys. So we don't also say we are experts in this, but only through God's grace why we're sitting here in front of you guys.
And the realization, but that even as married couples, we're still working through some things, right?
Yes.
And it may be the reason why we're here, we're just some steps ahead, but it doesn't mean we're 100, 200 steps ahead. But we've seen things that you maybe have not yet. So if we can help, it would be so good. If there's any questions, ma'am, just who's going to collect the questions if ever? Oh, okay, very strict, ma'am, very serious. Are you guys okay? Are you forcing people to write? Every time you better write a question. All right. One of the questions I would get often is, how do I know, if I don't sleep with the person, how do I know if we're really compatible? Diba kay ang auto has four tires, na pa'y spare tire, no? So it's like they're saying that that thought of testing the waters, diba? I think often that's discussed in smaller circles.
Yeah, like if you want to buy a shoe, you want to try it first. Or if you want to buy a car, you want to test drive it first. Oh my golly. Just imagine how many test drives will you have to do.
Correct.
Diba, if you're going to get into that. But, you know, that's actually an important question, no? for that. But
yeah.
But the way how I see it is as, how do we know? How do we know also that it's right? That's a key question there.
And what's scary is you go and jump on your test drive, you bypass God. Oh, that's the problem. You actually bypass God. You don't want to wait. You want to get it quick. So you test drive 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. But at the end of it, you feel also a piece of you is gone. So by the time you're test driving who you think the one is, you're so messed up already on the inside, emotionally, physically, and everything. So again, I don't know what kind of logic that is. So I want us to be wise also in the way we make those decisions. Ma'am, you can just run here. Really, it's all right. You don't have to.
I'll just add up to that.
Yeah, sure.
First and foremost, we want to make it clear, premarital sex is wrong. Okay? So we don't want to even play with fire in terms of the thought of entertaining it na, what if we're not compatible? Maybe we should try having sex first so we will know. The mere thought that you are thinking about that and the mere thought that there is act, you're acting on that. You know, from one person to another, you are actually destroying your body, your mind, because sex is not just body. Sex is psychological, sex is emotional, sex is spiritual. So if you are already getting into the act of sex premaritally, you're already destroying your story, your emotions, your mental, your spiritual life, your testimony even, most especially your testimony. So for us, no, it shouldn't even be thought of.
Yes, I think for me, you know, I live by this premise. I hear this all the time. Why buy a cow if you can get the milk for free? So if you're a guy, you get everything already. Yeah. Why still pursue? Yeah, right? Wala nang something to look forward to. Wala nang one. So again, if you treat each other already like married couples already, yeah. there's, again, you don't have to buy the cow. You don't have to yeah. Because you're getting it already. And therefore, there's no more intention to really work on a marriage, to get married and like that. And that's just the way how I see it. And how
I'll jump into one of the questions here. It says, can you really tell specifically if the Lord approves or intends your future or present partner? That feeling of, how do I know if the Lord is giving his thumbs up or thumbs down, you know, in a relationship? Anyone?
I think we can really speak about that because before we got married, we went through a lot of process. Yeah. JP was very sensitive to God's word before he even proposed to me. First thing that he did while we were dating, of course, things were not easy while we were dating. No, we had also complicated stories. But what he did before he even decided to propose was he actually distanced himself from me. Why? Because if he is emotionally involved, kung love lang, love na love, in love, Kaimi, as in we were in the clouds.
Chemistry first.
Chemistry.
Everything.
But he was his man of faith. And I really appreciated that he did that before he proposed because he was making sure that he was listening to God and yeah. not to his heart. Remember, young adults, the heart is deceitful above all else. That's what the Bible says. So you can't really depend on what you feel, but you have to listen to God. Yes. I think you can add a lot.
Yeah, just really quickly. The question is here is, how do you make decisions? Diba? And we shared this a few weeks ago, but for those who didn't come here, I mean, there are ways how you make decisions. You can be emotional about it, okay? If you love a person, you do it like, you know, you, okay? And that's what you choose, all right? Or you make a logical decision, okay? And that's how some people choose their spouse. However, sometimes they think that, okay, since I'm already of age, I'm well off already, then I can get married. But, you know, sometimes people also, they use also their emotions to make a decision to get in. And then later on, after 5 years, they realize, no, I made a wrong decision. I was just too emotional. So, you know, okay, if you think that you're logical today, the next 5 years, you get smarter. You get more mature. Yeah. And we always go back to our 5 years before and say, I wasn't as smart enough. And that's why we make decisions logical, emotional, okay? The third one is the one we would strongly suggest is that you make a God-based decision. Yeah. And you will know, okay, you will know also when you know how God thinks and feels and you hear from him. That's exactly why I had to distance myself emotionally from Shelo because I wanted to know. because I didn't want to be eating with my mistake, sleeping with my mistake, and talking with my mistake for the rest of my life.
I think, Pastor JP, another practical thing, that God uses people to confirm things as well. So if you see in your relationship, there are people that surround you that are cheering you on. I'm not saying look for somebody that will be on your side to cheer you on. No, if you're part of a community like this, you will see people that will actually approve of your relationship, and you're now accountable to certain people within the community. That approval can also be God telling you, hey, go for it. You know, we're cheering you on. We're praying for you in this whole process. Because God uses people. Just like He used today somebody like Tito Mark to sing and lead worship. That's God using Mark to lead you in worship. In this case, God can use people and the advice they give, your ninos and ninas in the future when you get married. Hey, milk them for advice. You know, milk them for all the experiences they've had. So on the most practical sense, if you need to hear from God, Lord, I need to hear from you right away, then get in a room with certain people that you know you want to be like in the next 10 years. You know, people that you want to emulate, that you know, hey, this person is hearing from God. Can I hear some godly counsel? You know, that's a really practical way to look at it as well. Oh, Shells, go. You can go.
There's a question.
We'll cover
here
as much as we can.
How to get, daming.
Yeah.
How to get over God's no, quote unquote, can it be a not yet? How to get over God's no? So is this question like saying, are you sure it's a no already? Or
wait,
diba? Because I really believe in every area of our life, when God says no, it can be not yet. Yeah. But you have to be sensitive enough, discerning enough, listening to God on the direction that He wants you to take. Because we also believe that delays and denials are ordained by the Lord.
True.
So how will you know if it's a no? You have to ask God and seek God. That's the only answer to that. And if you know His voice and you spend time with Him, you will know if it's a yes or a no. Clearly, when we seek God for anything, that doesn't have to be about relationship, about anything, we seek God on our knees to really ask Him, Lord, you have to make it clear with me. You have to show me the answer, and He will. Trust that He will. Trust Him that He will.
And on a practical sense, whenever we're talking about God answering, I think the issue is not what God wants to say, but it's really our patience. We're not willing to go through the process of waiting.
Yeah.
We want the answer yesterday. We want it quick. So, and the problem is when you're so bent toward an answer, you'll find the yes where you want. If God says no, don't stop yung the way you read it. No, don't stop. Okay, thank you, Lord. You just keep continuing because you can be bent over biased, looking for verses and people that will cheer you in your wrong. So that's why it's dangerous. What it requires is really patience to really wait and learn to hear from God through people, through His Word, etc., etc.
May connected na question dito. Yeah. Practical ways to learn patience in dating.
Yun, patience.
Patience in dating. So, when you are in the middle of waiting, is this the one or is it not? And you don't know if you're gonna move forward, you know. God is, di ba, it says in the Bible, He is the lamp, light unto our feet, a lamp unto our path. We always teach this to the young couples even when they make decisions. Now, when the Lord actually gives you light, you move forward. When you see that there's no light, it's like He is closing doors, then you have to pause back and ask God again. Because He is the light unto our feet and a lamp unto our path. He will show you the path.
There's a question, that always pops up. You know, what's the purpose of dating? Diba? Why do you date in the first place? If your purpose of dating is just because I want to be with somebody, he feels my need. Yes, I don't want to be alone. Diba? There has to be a purpose for dating. The fact is that, you really want to get to the next level of marriage. Yeah. That's why we date. No? Of course, you get to know the person because you want to make sure if this is the person that you want to marry. Although, you can't, like, as what he mentioned, you can't keep trying and testing and like that, but it's best to hear from God. And I hear a lot of stories wherein when it was when the lady or the man would say, Lord, I'm okay without you. Whether I have relationships, I'm whole already with you. When they have that kind of heart, yeah, that's when God already shows the other person and they have them
meet.
That's
actually how we met.
That's how we met.
We were two broken people when JP finally surrendered and said, Lord, that's it. I'm done with relationships and I really need your miracle. That's when he was also preparing my heart. When my heart was also broken in the past, and when I came back to the Lord, restored my relationship with the Lord, and I said, Lord, I don't need a man. I am fully restored. I am super in love with you. I don't need to date. That's the time that he gave JP to me. So I really believe that we all know these guys. Seek ye first, right? And all of these things will be added unto you.
And if I may add, the Genesis model, Adam didn't go out looking for Eve. Yes. God put Adam to sleep and then presented Eve. Yes. What was Adam doing before Eve arrived? He was working. He was naming the animals, he was farming, and you can read that in Genesis.
Yeah. He was involved
in
ministry.
Prepared the ground, he had learned, yes, you know, how to name the animals. And then when God looked at Adam, he says, it's not good for a man to be alone. And put Adam to sleep, he woke up, and then he presented Eve. And I think that's a good model to follow. That I'm not saying that like a crazy person, you're just in the corner of the room, Lord, present to me Eve, present to me Eve. I would be afraid if someone poofed here in front of me. But the point is, even Adam had to learn not to go ahead of God, but to wait. And it was just a position of receiving. And that's exactly what God did, yeah, you know? And Eve was the perfect one for him, even if she ate the fruit. Anyway, so I'll just look at this real quick. I'll just read this real quick now. Is it okay not to date a Christian when I myself am a Christian? And here's the logic behind it. I've seen non-Christians who handle relationships better than Christians. And I also know a fair amount of Christians that are toxic. I think there's so much truth to that. There are Christians that are really toxic, and there are also non-Christians that are toxic, and there are Christians that are safe to be with, and I think it goes both ways. But I think what's dangerous about this is the person who wrote this wants something now, unwilling to wait. The problem with this is, why will I go for the Christian that's so toxic? I've been in so many toxic Christian relationships. I'll just go for this person who's so kind, so loving. And then we justify that. And you say, well, this non-Christian is more Christian than you. Right? That whole argument, I think.
Again, it boils back to, are you willing to patiently wait on God? God will bring that person to you, don't try to analyze things. Just you and God. It was Adam and God in the garden first. It was just him and God. Yeah. So that relationship has to be really very intimate. And then involvement, and then Eve comes. Yeah.
Guys, if some of your questions don't get answered to the point that you want, we're also trying to cover for others. So I hope you're a little patient with us. But we'll try to move through. There's so much unfolding. Tips on how single people can get off the pressure of marriage or relationship. There's our culture kasi in the Philippines na, you should get into a relationship. When are you going to get married? And then you find yourself aging. You look at the mirror. You're not as young as you think you are. Any tips, though, to be able to, release that pressure that you don't feel like you need to get married right away?
Tips.
Tips?
If you are pressured, ignore the pressure.
Yeah.
Because in the first place, it's you who will be involved in a relationship, not your tita, not your tito, not your friends.
Yeah.
And if God did not say yes, then don't move forward. I really believe, don't settle, guys. Don't settle just because the pressure na ko. Sige, I will have a relationship already. The story of Lot. Diba, they were supposed to find the best land for them, for him and Abraham. And in the first thing that he saw, he settled there. When he settled there, he looked, he decided, he dwelled, and then what? What happened to him, diba? So his story says a lot. He was actually mentioned even in the New Testament, right? So we always make sure that you don't settle for anything less than what God has prepared for you. Yeah. Do you believe in second chances if your partner cheated on you? Oh.
Is this
the reaction of everybody?
This is like marriage
already?
No, I
think if this is boyfriend girlfriend, kung sige, ikaw, you answer for kung boyfriend girlfriend and then the person cheated. Kasi there's a lot of reason why a person cheats. It really speaks about background. It speaks about experiences. It speaks about the character. That's the reason why we also we tell young adults, the single people, before you even start dating, you get to know the person as a friend. Yes. Na all walls are down. There's no pretension. Para you know how they respond to circumstances, how they know how to respect people above them, below them, their parents, their family. You have to get to know the person because you never know.
I just want to clarify. Is that a boyfriend-girlfriend relationship?
Well, it did
or
not say.
Married?
It did not say. If your partner cheated on you. So we'll assume na boyfriend-girlfriend and we can answer also if married.
If your boyfriend or girlfriend cheated on you, another way to look at that is that that might be a God thing. God allowed you to see something to warn you for the danger that's set up for you. It can be a trap in the long run. A habit man in his life or her life. And I'm not saying you just don't mind the person. The person needs to get help because like Shello said, that person is also acting out something probably related to his past.
Yes.
Probably he's seen growing up. Because when a chronic cheating, there's really something wrong internally. So don't just discard the person and say, hey, I hate you, you go to hell. Puede for a while. You don't say that, okay, because you're hurt, right? But tell the person to get some help. Hey, I need you to get some help. Because if you keep forgiving and then it keeps repeating itself and then you walk down the aisle with the person and then it shows up in your marriage, then you didn't exercise wisdom as well. Yeah. You had the chance to really stop, breathe, and say, Lord, wait. I know this person is a Christian or whatever, but if you did not seek help to make it, try to make it work, then that might be a God thing, protecting you. Because every answer God gives you is also protection. Even his no's. When he says no, sometimes it's him closing a door. Brian, if you enter that door, you're dead. So I'm going to close it. So I hope you get that, but I think that's so tricky to answer.
Well, of course, for me, the way I would see it, you know, a pattern is always better than a promise. Yeah. When you're choosing a spouse or something like that, of course, that's why now, of course, you're choosing whether this or that, but everyone can promise. You know, like for example, if I say, you know, I promise I will preach next week in Korean. I promise. What I promise. Who here would believe that I can preach already in Korean? No, diba? It still would be hard. Yeah, but I promise. I promise to do it again. But okay, what's the pattern? Yeah. What's my pattern? I cannot speak in Korean. I even have a hard time speaking Bisaya. Pastor Manu knows so much more than me.
Right? Through patterns actually dictate what a person is like. So, for instance, if you're a lady, you watch how he treats his parents. You watch how he loves on his pets. You watch how he loves on his stuff. Because those are indicators of what type of person he is. You know, is he honoring to his parents? Because if he can't even honor his parents, who was there even before you came? Why will he honor you? Yeah. Right? If he can't honor his tito. Whatever the story is, well, they're this, they're that, they're this. It doesn't matter. Because a mature person will be able to say, okay, I don't agree with the person that's over the authority over me in the house, but because he's my dad, she's my mom, see, Lord, I'll just honor, keep my mouth shut. Well, that's a good thing. You know, you see that, wow, if he can do that for them, this person can do it for me. Again, that's pattern. Pattern over promise. Yeah, plenty. Okay. There's some I'm hiding in my shoe, para di ma-obvious. When, it says here, this is a good one. When did you, in the duration of your dating life, realize that this is the person I want to spend the rest of my life with? It's a good one. How long were you together?
Before getting married.
Mm. Yes, boy, abunda. So,
4 years.
4 years.
Yes. 4 years. You did 4 years.
4 years.
So at what point in your four-year relationship did you kind of know she's the one?
Okay, so I was 27 years old when I said already that, Lord, I'm tired of playing around. You know, I really want to meet my future spouse. I truly believe that, well, it was my mom who asked me, Jabe, if I still believe that the same God who created miracles before can do a miracle in your life today. And I said, yes. And she asked me what would be those two miracles that I would say would be from the Lord. I would say first that He would bless my business, and second that I would meet my future spouse. So it was really like a decision already, really to get married already. That was really my intention. And so I wanted to pray and ask the Lord, He will also show me. That's when I had to let go of things, and that's the time also Shiloh came in my life. You know, her story was so clear that the Lord matched what her type and, of course, my type was in her.
But we want to reiterate then that we don't really advise long engagements. It's dangerous because the moment your girlfriend and boyfriend, I don't care who you are, it's a race to the bed. Okay, you can't be holding hands forever. That's weird, right? How long have you been holding hands? 10 years now, Pastor? Just holding hands? You know, beso-beso? It doesn't work that way. It literally, it's a race to the bed. Some may be faster, some may be slower. But that's why we don't do prolonged engagements. One of my good friends in Manila, he the way he did it, didn't even go through the girlfriend-boyfriend stage, directly proposed. They got married in 6 months. And 3 kids, it works because they were friends a long time. And one day it just clicked for him. I told him, bro, are you going to ask her to be your girlfriend? No, man. I'm going to get down on my knee and I'm going to propose. And she said, yes, done.
When you have the peace from your parents and everything around you, you will know man good na this is the right time already when there's so much peace. There's no more questions. There's no more obstacle that is stopping you. Because if there are obstacles, pa, you wait. Wait lang. JP and I did not force it. When his parents were not yet for me, we did not force it. We did not say, it's going to be you and me against the Lord. Against the world.
Teka lang.
No way, diba?
I like this boyabun na questioning. So there was a time that your parents were not for her.
Yes.
Oh, I like to hear
yes.
this.
Yes. So I was a single parent.
So how did you?
As many of people know.
Single parent ka.
Yes.
So how did you reverse that?
Here's the thing.
No, bro. I'm asking her. I want to hear her. No. See,
here's the thing. She's gonna answer since it. Okay. Here's the thing. Go ahead.
Because
no, I'll see it first.
Because both of us were so whole in the Lord. Yeah. It was really okay even if we break up. I wasn't even after a relationship. It's like JP coming into my life was a bonus. And we were ready to give it up when we found out that his parents were not for me. Yeah. Valentine's, let me speak.
He's afraid of what you might say.
No. But what you guys have to understand is the Lord works out everything for the good of those who love Him and those who are called according to His purpose. He saw my heart. He saw JP's heart. Yeah. He worked things around us to make sure that we have peace. How? What happened? Mm. I was a single parent. What happened to make his parents' hearts soften up? His sister became a single parent. All of these things worked out for the good of those who love the Lord. Even for his sister, who also have received a second chance by God. Redeemed, restored. Yeah. So if you have a life that is fully surrendered to Him, I really believe there's nothing else to worry about. You just have to trust Him. Continue to trust Him step by step, day by day. Because there's no more questions anymore if you just know how to seek God. It will be easier for all of you. Don't force it if it's just your earthly nature, your flesh nature that will be making decisions. Because if you're just using your earthly, the way that you think is just by yourself and not considering on what the Lord really wants for you, it's going to be hard. But if you have that tug of war, don't have that tug of war. Let the Lord do it. Surrender everything to Him. That's why it was so easy for us to decide na this is the time because everything just worked out for us. Sorry.
I just wanted to reiterate things that happened for us smoothly. Of course, I thought this one. I said, Lord, I thought you wanted Shelo for me. You know the qualities that she's looking for. I have it already like that. And at that time, I was praying already for her also. And so I was like saying, Lord, I thought you wanted me already and us together. It's a miracle. It's a wonderful story. And here, of course, my parents were not for her yet. Okay, so this was the time I was saying, Lord, if you want, and this is crucial, okay? Because this is when I said, Lord, if you want Shelo for me, okay, then, touch my dad's heart. Yeah. Touch my dad's heart. But, okay, if you don't want us together, then break us apart. Yeah. There was still that area of Lord, Lord, it's still on your hands. And I think, that's my dad's heart. And then a few weeks after, I found out that my sister also became a single mom. And the Lord pala was working in my dad's heart, in my mother-in-law's heart, her heart, my heart, trusting. So the Lord's still working behind the scenes.
Amen.
Don't think that was just the...
Before you say that, I love the fact that you brought that up, that you were a single parent, because one of the purposes of question and answers is not to condemn people. I want you to see that God is a God of second chances. This is a story in front of you that was supposed to not go well, but it went well. The Lord can turn things around. And you can even know more in-depth stuff about their life. But really, that's what makes it so unique. Because when the hand of God is in it, it can look so ugly and so filthy. But if His hand is in it, if you commit to the process, He can really turn things around. Then it becomes a testimony. Go ahead, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. Let's ask this question. How to keep a Christian relationship healthy and growing? Can it be cheesy at times?
Join young adults every Wednesday.
Yes, of course. You can have fun, right? But of course, clean fun. There are boundaries. Even if you're both Christians, there are boundaries. Just like what Pastor Brian said, when it comes to long engagements, there's a temptation to fall. So you are making sure that when you are going out, there are boundaries, that you don't sleep in each other's houses. You're not alone in a dark car. All of these boundaries you have to set so that you can enjoy a clean dating fun. And when you look back, when you're married, you'll say, thank you, Lord, you saved us. Thank you, Lord, that you kept us pure. Thank you, Lord, that you protected our testimony. And then later on, when you talk about the Lord, wow, what a beautiful story, because you waited and you had fun as a Christian couple.
Okay. Yeah, I think you have to be creative, to find really ways to do it. Oh, go ahead, ma'am. You can go and read.
When is the right time to get married? When to know when you should move on or fight for the relationship? Maybe answer that. To move on or fight for the relationship. Why are you moving on, separating, or fight? We don't know the reason, the context. How to keep a space for Jesus?
Oh, that's good. Break up. No, I'm just kidding. Keep a space for Jesus.
How to keep a space for Jesus?
Yeah, that's a good question, because when you prepare a space for Him, that means you're willing to make adjustments and move things aside. And sometimes it can be that it's a toxic relationship that you have to move aside and dial it down a bit in order to give space for Him. So I think you'll know. We don't have to be the one to tell you. You'll know if you're not spending time with Him enough.
Yeah.
You'll know there's going to be a dryness that will settle in your heart. You know when something is off, and you can compare yourself to even a month ago, 2 months ago, you'll see a decline in your life. You're smart enough to see that. And you see, okay, what changed in the last 30 days, in the last quarter? Okay, it's this new job or this new person in my life. Okay, Lord, how can I make adjustments so that I can go back to how it was? So yeah, I think it takes a lot of self-evaluation, but be realistic as well, okay? In my case, there's a question here about how long should you be together. In my case, we were together for 3 years. We got married right on the dot of our third year. Honestly, for me, I really wanted it to be shorter than that. Honest to goodness, if I went over, probably I'd sin. For sure, yan. Just the way we were together. And I knew if we went on our fourth year, sigurado, we were going to go to the bed, right? That wasn't the reason why we got married, but I was watching the time very closely. So we decided together, hey, I propose, let's get married. By the third year, we did it already now. Getting married, walked down the aisle, kept ourselves pure by the grace of God. But I felt like there were times, it's like you're hanging by a thread. Just to be honest, no? Oh, Lord, this is so hard. You know, there are days it's easy, there are days it's hard. But Shelo's correct, maintain the boundaries, be wise with your time and your personal space.
Yes, I truly believe that Jesus, our God, is a jealous God. He wants to be even above your spouse or your girlfriend or your boyfriend. You know, he wants to be number one. The time you put your girlfriend or your kids even above God, he somehow reminds you in a way. And I'm telling you, if you're gonna put your relationship right now over Jesus, okay, he is a jealous God. He's gonna make sure that he is the priority.
Here's a real practical question, which is so practiced today. Is it okay to do yung living in? Because a lot of the person's workmates are okay with live-ins. What is God's view on this?
That's the same thing as a while ago. Like you're testing first before you want to. You know, in the long run, there's a lot of repercussions that will actually affect the relationship more. Again, why buy a cow if you can get the milk for free? Yeah. Think about that. You are the lady. And if I was the father, if this is me, you know, and I want to be honored, you know, I took care of my daughter.
Yeah. Ang living in is, aside from the sexual sin involved, it's very dishonoring to parents.
It's very dishonoring to the father.
Biblically speaking, it's honor your parents so that you may live a full life and prosper. So the moment you do that, you're dishonoring lolo, lola, daddy, mommy, both sides, actually, both sides. You dishonor your own parents as well because they raised you better than that, diba? Kumbaga.
Yeah, for the women specifically, do not allow yourself to be treated that way. Don't sell yourself short. If the man that you are with right now is only offering live-in, forget it, ladies. You are valuable, more valuable than that. So please have that integrity and that courage to distance yourself from that relationship. I really believe that God has prepared the best for you. He loves you. You are His daughter. So why settle? He has the best plan for you.
Yes, and when your life isn't in order, the blessings don't really flow. You know what I mean? You want things to be in order. Even the way first you get married, you court, engaged. There's a process of things. And guys, the Bible is not a corny thing, okay? It's there because it's there to make guardrails, to protect you later on. And that's why they tell you all these things, okay?
Is this helping you guys? Are you bored? I mean, time is up, but we'll read a few more questions. Sir, maybe you can read some.
If sa marriage lang ang my forever, how can you forgive your partner who committed adultery and cheated? I think it's the same thing. How can you forgive? I think that goes for both. It could be a no, but you know, there's this song. It was our song also in a wedding called "God Bless the Broken Road That Led You." Straight to you. God, let me know. What's that? God bless the broken road. Let me straight to you. Yeah. So all these things that are happening, you know, when he did it, it's probably leading you to the right person. And perhaps it could have been straight to the person, pero you wanted pa kasi here, you wanted pa kasi there, you wanted to take the side trip and all like that. You want to try and to test. Rather than the Lord's preparing, I mean, this is what we always say, you know, how I wish that I was, you know, I listened to the Lord, I waited, and just waited for her.
Yeah. We always talk about that. Yeah. We're like, now that in our, Yes.
What if I
just
waited?
Now we're married for 17 years, almost 17 years. But when we look back, we always talk about that. We're like, we should have waited for each other, no? I mean, yes, those relationships or those that background of yours is leading you to where you are right now. We all know that. Experiences in the past, we all know that. But now, listen to us. On our 17th year, we still talk about it now. We should have waited for each other. We should have waited. No?
Forgiveness is a big thing. That case that's there. Because sometimes we think that because you broke off with the person, it's as good as forgiving the person. Now, you can break up with the person and still hold the unforgiveness in your heart decades from that moment. And you can also be in the relationship and totally forgive the person. So I think it's two different things, that you punish a person by sending them away or breaking them up. But yung unforgiveness, that's a heart issue that you need to deal with. And I promise you, if you carry that in your heart, you'll bring it to your next relationship. And you'll be repeating cycles. And we're going to talk about stuff like this in the camp, honestly. We're going to talk about heart issues and why you are the way you are. Why are there repeating cycles? Why can't I break free from it? And the whole camp is actually designed for that. We'll end the camp just laying things down and praying to God that people will be set free. But unforgiveness is such a big issue that people neglect. So you repeat the cycle of your life, relationship one to relationship five. Some way, somehow, it's like you dated the same person. You repeated the same thing. So we'll deal with things like that. I don't think we have time, na sir. One more. Sige.
Two more.
Sige, Valentine's.
It says here. Okay, it says here. Is it morally right to date more than one at the same time?
Oh, that's a good question.
This is what dating. I want to tell the person. What if you were the second one that the person was also trying to date? That's my question.
I think you already know the answer to your question.
Okay. But I just want to let you know, what if you were the person, or the third person, okay, your girl was also dating at the same time? Think about
that's
it.
That's the answer.
That's my answer. But anyway.
And words
I,
of it.
Okay, I honestly never, I've never done that. But I can imagine how awkward that would have been. It's like you're fishing. Even if you say, no, it's just coffee or dessert or, but if you're doing that as a cycle.
No, but really, in a way.
Yeah.
There was a time in my life.
Yun. This is what I live for, moments like this. So can you tell us a bit?
I had a crush here and I had a crush there like that and ganun lang.
You set guys, kamo naman.
Pero hindi talaga nga, I do that. Never mind. It's going to go so much longer. I don't want to open a can
He's
of worms.
He's starting to regret his past.
That's why if I was the one who was also being two-time, it wouldn't. Okay?
Or I think if that was your daughter, would you be okay with that?
Yes.
If she was the second or the third date?
Oh, and this is the thing also. Don't think that if you're a friend of a person who cheats, okay, and you allow it, okay? I know some people wherein they just allowed it for others. Eventually, the person allowed it. This person also experienced somebody also being cheated by his or her own spouse.
Yeah.
If you allow it.
Yeah.
Because it's like you're also, you are.
Consent. Silence is consent.
You are an accomplice. Diba? So it's really important. Okay, don't just think that. Since you're supporting, I know also that, you know, and it's sad. Why? Because it happened to my sister. Okay, so it's that way. She was helping something. It also happened to her. Okay.
Are we good?
There's one more here.
There's a lot actually. Okay. Any words of advice on how to make a marriage grow stronger and longer?
Very simple. If you're married, join us on Saturday. Okay? We have this once a month. Young couples, okay? We're here.
It's a good community, guys.
It's a good community for you.
And to make a marriage stronger and longer, it's a commitment. It's a decision day by day to love your spouse, whether they're lovable that day or not. Because it's a covenant. It's not a feeling. It's not just emotions. It's a covenant between you and your spouse and God. So it's a decision.
And I had a very special Valentine's dinner yesterday.
I did not feel like preparing anything for him, honestly, because he's been so busy. Yes. My love language, ayan na, naglabas na. My love language is quality time. But he hasn't been there for me the past how many days. But guys,
that's why I wanted to take her out. I said, if not tonight, let's do it yesterday.
I did not want him to take him out because it felt forced. So, but you know, guys, what I did? I told him, love is a decision. I will love you today. I will serve you today. I make you Italian pasta. I prepared the table well. I initiated the romance.
With heart pa yung, ganon yung napkin.
Wait, I have a question. Maybe it'll help them. On Saturday, it's a young couple's thing, right?
Yes.
And there's going to be like a panel as well?
Yes, with Pastor Brian and Mika.
Okay. But for that, will we allow young adults to sit in and listen? I'm just asking you, but whoever wants, they can just, maybe they're in a relationship, they want to, up to you. For this Saturday.
Yes, I really believe pwede, kasi we have an activity
oh, yeah,
that
I'm
is
just
really
doing
fun
a,
for
an
this
invite.
Saturday.
What time can you promote it on Saturday?
6:15.
6:15, be here. It's very important that again, we learn how many hours and years to become a good a doctor, lawyer, nurse, and like that, how many units do you study to become a good spouse, a good wife, a good husband? You don't, right? That's why we're here. In fact, you being here already is a good community, okay? Because we're already showing you what it takes to be a good spouse. Because what you practice here, again, huh? There are no such thing as marriage problems. There's no such thing as marriage problems. It's people with problems who get married. Then it becomes a marriage problem. If you have issues in life, you come together, you bring it into the marriage, that becomes a marriage problem. But so very important, you are whole in Christ, you are whole in Christ, and what really brings the two of us together is because we're bonded closer to God, and that's why we are also drawn closer to each other.
It's really only through God's grace that a marriage will last, and not just last or just survive. It will thrive. It will blossom because you have the right perspective. You have the right heart. You have one vision, one direction together.
So there are good marriages, but you can also have a great marriage.
Yes.
And that's what we're always doing. You can be an average young adult, but you can also be an extraordinary young adult by starting to be here and listening.
Yeah, so on Saturday, we'll close in prayer in a while, but on Saturday, if you can make it 6:15, just approach Pastor JP and Shello, and we'll probably sit you guys in a certain area so at least you don't feel awkward that you're around couples.
Yeah.
We'll make room for you to be here. And you can leave whenever you want if you just want to sit in and listen just for that Saturday because normally we don't allow singles to be there. So, special naman.
But this is good that you see already, okay, what's in store.
Yeah. Especially this last question. It's just, given that you're both Christians and are dating, then here comes marriage and he or she is starting to show off his or her bad side. How do you deal with it? I have a lot of news for you. Even after you get married, a lot of bad sides gonna show.
Actually, there'll be a lot more.
As in, you'll get shocked. Like, this is
yes.
Right now. Right now, you argue like that. You go home and you're okay.
Yeah.
But when you're married, when you argue, you know.
You don't have a choice.
You have no choice. You're gonna be sleeping with the enemy.
Correct.
Yes.
Okay. You'll be sleeping with the enemy.
And you will see each other's quirks and weaknesses. Yeah. And until now, we still realize, discover a lot of things about each other. Na, ha? Inana di ay siya when it comes to this situation. Ah, inana di ay ko. You will also discover a lot of things about yourself. So it's iron sharpens iron, but it's fun, guys.
That's
the journey is fun.
That's why the first 5 years, don't invest in a king size bed. Single, ma walang choice. Pag single, nakakaroon kayo together. Back to back pa rin.
That's why it's important always to have people around, the right people around
you. Correct.
And
community,
people, community,
accountability, life group, stay in church.
That is what I did, okay? Of course, I have mentors in life for business, in church, okay, in parenting, marriage also. I have people who I can just call and talk to. I surround myself with people like that. And there are people also, there are mentors in life. They're willing also to do that.
And that's a decision you had to make. Yeah. That's a decision you have to make. Yeah.
And that's also available here in church. So you're in a good church, guys. Okay?
Amen. All right. Guys, thank you so much. We did our best to cover. There's probably around 15 to 20 that are unanswered. But can you stand with us tonight as we pray? I'm going to ask the rose among the... I don't know how to describe this guy. But anyway, can you... Yeah, we'll just pray. And honestly, if you feel like this is something that helped you, then join us in this prayer. Let it be something that you're talking to God to directly as well, as Shelo leads us in prayer.
Father, we just want to thank you, Lord, for who you are in our lives. Thank you for this wonderful day, Lord, that you have even given to us. Father, we celebrate love. Yes. We celebrate you because you are love. You are the creator of love. And Lord, we know, Father, all of the issues of our hearts, we know that you are so much into the details of our lives, God. And nothing, Lord God, is nothing that we're going through is you don't see them. We know that you see everything, Lord God. And we know all the concerns of our hearts, Lord God, are under your control. I pray, Father, for each and every one here, Lord, that they will continue, Lord, to prioritize you. Because you are our great lover. You are the one who gives us love. You loved us first. That's why we love God. Lord, I pray, Father, for each and everyone who are here, especially those who are single, maybe those who are broken, maybe those who have a lot of things that they're going through, Lord God, and there's just so much tears, Lord God. And we know, Lord, that you see all the pain that they feel. We know, Lord God, all the questions, Lord God, in their hearts and in their minds. And none of those, Lord God, are overlooked. We just want to thank you, Lord God, that you cover all of these ladies and the men here, Lord God, with your love tonight and every day of their lives. Salamat, good Lord, that you love us so much, Father. And that in everything that we're going through, Lord, we know that we can trust you because you are a good, good Father. And nothing, Lord God, nothing that is for us will pass us by, Lord. And we don't have to worry about anything because you are in control. You are sovereign. And you love us so much. Salamat, good Lord, that we are in this community. And I pray, Father, that you strengthen each and everyone here tonight, especially even those who are volunteers, who are leaders, Lord God. Thank you, Lord, for giving us even wisdom, Lord God, and even the courage to lead the people here. Salamat, Lord, for City Church. Thank you, Lord, for the pastors here. Thank you, Lord God, that as we even speak, Lord God, here on stage, that you also protect each and every testimony, Lord God. We know, Lord, that there's an enemy who is there to kill, steal, and destroy, but you are victorious. Thank you, Father. We have victory in you. And in everything that we're going through, Father, we know that you have already overcome the world. We love you, Father. We thank you for your love. We thank you for this day of love. Because of you, we can celebrate it, Father. We love you. We glorify you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Thank you, guys. God bless you. We'll see you guys next week. Yes? Okay, bring a friend. God bless.